Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of Bouncing Around. Another guest, very exciting stuff because as you know, hallowed ground to be a guest on Bouncing Around. We only invite the best of the best. And today to discuss what I think is a landmark piece in basketball writing on feel. We'll be exploring it with Evan Zaucha. He's done so much fantastic work. I enjoyed immensely. Easyhoops.co. Bit of a blog. That's where you can find it. It'll be linked. Premium Hoops. Okay. He's got an incredible podcast, but Sense and Scalability, one of the most important podcasts out there currently discussing the philosophy of basketball, which maybe doesn't get discussed enough. Forget the hot takes. Let's get into the Nietzsche of it all. Maybe we will today, but Evan, how you doing, man?
I'm doing great. Thank you guys so much for having me on. Truly an honor, like you said, hallowed ground in terms of the guests you guys have had on already. Some like really esteemed names. So you know, I'm a little starstruck being here, especially on the Handsome Boy podcast. But yeah, no, it's been an awesome day. I'm excited to get into the nitty gritty of feel and kind of the science behind it. So, yeah.
How about you, Evan? Other Evan for this podcast? I know that's like maybe a pejorative, but for this podcast, are you other Evan since we like to elevate our guests?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I didn't write, I haven't written anything really, but that piece on feel is, I'm the other Evan for all intents and purposes. So.
Oh, yeah. You only crafted the YouTube channel that every great writer has used as a reference point to collect data for the past 7 years. No big deal. Nobody knows or anything. I'm just some schlub in a Detroit hat. And so here, watchers, I should say, why the Detroit hat? This guy was wearing a Yankees hat last week. What is he, an ass? What is he doing? I'll let you know. I wear the ball cap of the city that is most well represented in our listening analytics from the past week. So if you want to see the hat of your state, of your place, of your city, you just got to share Bouncing Around a little bit more often. But okay, Evan, feel is, you know, some people are trying to, what would the term be? They're trying to introduce it as a replacement for basketball IQ. And that's because, you know, feel seems to be more applicable to what's happening on the court rather than IQ, which if you know what IQ, where it comes from, the intelligence quotient, how it's measured, it doesn't make sense relative to basketball. And in a predominantly black league, trying to apply IQ from largely racist mediums and institutions, I think has gone awry far too many times. So here we are, feel for the listeners, for the watchers. Can you tell us what your interpretation of that is?
Yeah, sure. So like you said, I kind of wanted to redefine feel. Well, specifically, I wanted to move away from basketball IQ because the science behind IQ itself is, it would be polite to call it garbage. I think you could call it something much worse and be accurate. So I, first of all, wanted to redefine that a little bit. And kind of as I got into scouting more and more, especially scouting the draft, I saw and read a lot of scouting reports where people mentioned feel, and it's helpful and useful for sure because everybody knows what that means. But I really wanted to kind of apply my background to break that down a little bit more. And kind of how I've broken it down so far is the sum of a player's pattern recognition, visual processing, and processing speed. And so those three kind of attributes combined, one, have a background in modern neuroscience and academic research. So there is backing to them that is believable, proven, and understandable. And you can use a consistent definition. And two, I think it just better describes, like in a more nuanced way, the sub-skills that define a player and his decision-making on the court.
Those three pillars that you were discussing of feel, if you could explain what each one is to us in, you know, we'll dive further into it as the podcast goes on, but maybe give us an example of something we might see in game as well.
Yeah, for sure. So pattern recognition is kind of the first one that I describe in the piece. And I think that's because it comes first in the chronology of decision-making and what you're doing in terms of seeing and thinking on the basketball court. And so pattern recognition to me is the ability to kind of take account of yourself, the ball, and the other nine players on the court, and how all of these variables are moving as time passes in a play, in a game, et cetera. And so pattern recognition is not only the ability to kind of recognize all these variables, but to apply past experiences gleaned usually through like copious experience playing the game, but also through carefully crafted training regimens and drills and stuff like that, that allow you to leverage your past experience to more quickly solve problems on the court. So visual processing to me is kind of the information acquisition phase of this process. And so you're seeing all these variables on the court. It's not good enough to just see them once, but you have to constantly be reassessing where these variables are on the court. And so, you know, you're interpreting the movement of other players, where the ball is going, you know, even more niche kind of even subconscious things that you might see, like footwork positioning, hip direction, stuff like that. And you're using that information and constantly updating your understanding of where those variables are. That to me is visual processing. And especially, I think I pointed out in the piece, spatial recognition. So not only do you need to understand where these players are, but you need to understand how the spacing between them and where the ball is in relation to that spacing and where the rest of the players are, how that affects the way decisions are made on the court and what might happen next. And then processing speed is pretty much just the speed at which you update all of these things, the speed at which you acquire this information, the speed at which you use that information to, or rather use your past experiences to leverage this information, and how quickly you can leverage that information to make the decision you want to make.
Okay, so as you highlighted, you had your list of eight things, the prospect development web, as it were. Why is dribbling harder in your eyes to improve upon your craft in it than feel, for example?
Yeah, I think that's a really great question. And it touches on a lot of what I believe about skill development, especially in a basketball sense. And so dribbling is, I mean, put very simply, only one player can dribble the ball at one time. And generally, coaches like to win basketball games, especially at the professional level. And winning basketball games means putting players in the position where not only are they most likely to succeed, but putting them in that position makes your team more likely to succeed. And so you're generally going to give the dribbling opportunities, the ball handling opportunities, the primary initiation responsibilities to your best ball handler. And so if you don't come into whatever level of basketball we're analyzing here, could be I'll use the NBA as an example. If you don't come into the NBA with like a requisite baseline of dribbling ability, you're probably not going to get a lot of opportunities to develop your ability to dribble in game situations. And I touch upon it in the piece, and it's kind of germane, I think, to how I think about skill development, but those game-like reps are really, really important for developing those skills. And I think they're even more important for developing dribbling, because dribbling is such a game of counter and reaction. Like, you need to read and react, and your ability to kind of apply counters is directly dependent on how many times you've tried those counters and the success that you've had with those counters in similar experiences in the past. And so if you come into the league and you haven't had a whole lot of experience dribbling the ball, you may be able to get... This is a tricky one, because I think you can get up to a baseline level of dribbling ability enough that you're going to be able to put the ball on the deck and the coach will trust you, but you're not going to be doing a lot of the advanced ball handling that like you think of when you think of Kyrie Irving, perhaps. That is a lot of times people think of as an inherent ability, but I think it's more just that these players are enabled to do so from a young age and they get more game-like reps than everybody else does, and so they get much, much better at it. Now, I will say Kyrie is outlier good at it in a way that I cannot explain. But I will say also that I haven't done all the research, I think, quite yet on how dribbling develops, and it's the next thing I want to look at. So it's kind of going to be the sequel to the feel piece for me, and I'm working on the lit review for it now, so I'm really excited about it. I think it's going to be a really interesting lens through which to look at skill development. And also to kind of more deeply explain from a scientific perspective one of the skills that sometimes we take for granted as analysts.
Breaking news on bouncing around. Thank you for sharing that with us. In soccer, for example, you highlight, you know, certain drills that were played when you were growing up, when you were in youth soccer and that kind of stuff. In the piece, Do you think that basketball is one of the pinnacle sports when it comes to feel, just because there's so much stimuli to react to constantly? There's very little isolated stuff in basketball outside of the free throw line, even like a sideline out of bounds play, which is supposed to be quite, you know, rote in a lot of ways. You run your action. There's a read and react aspect. But are there other sports that interest you as far as how they relate to feel?
Yeah, for sure. Like you mentioned, my background in soccer is kind of how I started to think about feel, and some of those parallels that you can draw from soccer to basketball also apply to other sports. We were talking about it in the group chat the other day, and I want to say it was our good pal Henry Ward who introduced me to the term, but the term that he used and that I like to use now is invasion sports. And so this is basically defined as any sport where an offense is attacking a defense and trying to converge on a goal to score in some way. You know, in basketball, it's obviously putting the ball in the hoop. But what makes basketball so special in this regard, and why I think it's probably, like you said, I would agree it's the best medium in which to study kind of feel and spatial awareness, is because the way that I look at feel changes based off of the parameters of the game. And the biggest parameter that makes decision-making happen more quickly is the space on the court, and specifically the size of the court. And so in basketball, most of the basketball happens in the half court. And so you're restricted to half of a playing field that is already, I believe, smaller than most professional soccer fields. And so, you know, when you pack 10 players and a ball into that half a court that is already smaller than a soccer field, you're utilizing a pretty small space, and that's going to result in more decisions made and also quicker decisions made. And so you, as a scientist, like, I like to look at sample size, and I think that's important for drawing conclusions. And we see this all the time when people want to look at advanced statistics, or you know, how those affect or describe how a player has played so far in a season. The number of reps is an important size of sample, and you're going to get more decision-making reps in a basketball court, probably in half court, than you are on a soccer field a lot of times. But I do think the concepts apply to multiple sports, especially invasion sports. And one of the coolest things about releasing the feel piece for me was just like having all these people flood my DMs, almost just like explaining how my piece was about basketball, but it related and struck home really important concepts for them in their own sports. I got messages about lacrosse. I got messages about soccer. It really kind of expands across the sports spectrum, but I do think basketball is probably the best sport in which to study it at this time, given the rules being the way they are.
This might be a little bit too expansive to try and answer right now, but if we look at a sport like basketball that is an invasion sport, you know, to use that term, it seems like you could look at the men's soccer team for the United States. There's so much money put into it, and still they have like not a great return on that investment. And then the women's, they get that. It's much better. But the thing that interests me is that, do you think that invasion sports are dependent on high competition to create a greater turnout at the pro level? And then if you don't have high competition in that invasion sport, do you think that it's important to have a subsequent invasion sport in the culture to try and teach read and react situations to players? So for like Hakeem Olajuwon, Pascal Siakam, Joel Embiid, the read and react of soccer, very big in helping them develop how they would read and react in basketball. But if you grew up in a, let's say like Scotland, where it's like hurling or something like that, these isolated sports or something like that, I think it would be really difficult to try and succeed in an invasion sport, a read and react game. Do you think that'll limit how it grows in certain countries? Or do you think there's a way to get around the competition level and train feel in other ways?
That's a really interesting question. And it touches on kind of a lot of my development philosophy from different angles. So to answer your question in short, I don't think it would hinder development of these kinds of skills and the success in like basketball related skills, especially feel and decision making in the long term. But I do think it would introduce kind of an initial hurdle that is harder to jump, in the sense that I think of development a lot as how do you have to develop to succeed versus how would you like to develop, right? So like a good advantage or a good example I think of is Nikola Jokic wearing his jersey today, my favorite player in the NBA. Shout out Nikola Jokic, going to be MVP, super happy about that. Jokic is a generally pretty slow-footed guy, but he's very technical and he understands how the footwork works. And so after he kind of got the footwork down, he can become more deceptive with that footwork because he understands how it's perceived. But Jokic probably developed that ability to kind of read footwork and his own like super advanced technical footwork, his understanding of angles, his passing ability and things of that nature, kind of how he sees the court, because those other solutions weren't readily available to him. He couldn't brute force athleticism his way through lower levels of basketball. He probably had a pretty significant strength advantage, but eventually you're going to run up against a brick wall and that strength advantage is not going to be enough to solve the problem. And so people and players in sports have to find different ways to solve the problem that fit them and their skill sets in that moment. And that's why I think those game-like decision-making drills and those game-like reps in practices are so important, is because you need an opportunity to try and fail as much as possible, especially younger when the results don't matter as much. And I like that you touched on the U.S. soccer example. I think U.S. sports culture is a pretty big perpetrator of the opposite, in the sense that, kind of like I touched on before, coaches want to win basketball games and competition is important. Competition, I'm not going to say that competition isn't important, because it's super critical, but I think sometimes the American mentality of developing athletes, especially at the youth level, is so focused on how do I win games now so that I can get promotions as a coach, or, you know, so that my players can be seen as winners and more desirable at the next level. I think sometimes that mentality loses the forest for the trees. And so the example you give of U.S. soccer is a good one, because I think U.S. soccer, the athletes are super, like the athleticism threshold is super high for U.S. soccer. The U.S. has a bunch of high-level athletes. And if you're not playing basketball, football, soccer, or basketball, football, hockey, baseball, whatever, soccer is right there for you. And plenty of high-level athletes end up playing soccer in the U.S. But where the U.S. has classically lacked in the soccer sense is kind of that tactical understanding, especially the desire to play or the ability to play the beautiful game. On the contrary, the Barcelona youth development system is world-renowned, and they turn out athletes who, on the whole, generally have just like an astounding level of feel, of ability to kind of dissect these spatial problems. And so I do think competition is important, but I think there needs to be a balance, which is a little bit of a cop-out answer. You need the game to matter, so that people aren't just like, players aren't just like messing around trying things that are never going to be applicable to real games. But you need to keep in mind that you're trying to develop players at the youth level. You want to make your players the best that they can be. The coach's job is to develop his players and maximize the team's performance given the way the players play. And so, yeah, competition's important, but I do think, you know, you have to focus on technical development. And that sometimes means putting players in positions where maybe they're not going to utilize that skill at the professional level, but they're going to get something out of it. A good example, when I talk to coaches, of why I like to give young big men like guard-like reps, ball handling reps, decision-making reps, as maybe even a pick and roll ball handler as much as possible, is because you look at a case like Anthony Davis. Anthony Davis was a guard until I believe his junior year of high school. And then he just shot up and he's 6'11". What makes him such a special prospect is that not only does he have the excellent agility, footwork, and just, he's just so quick and so dexterous as a big man, but he leveraged a lot of his experience as a guard. And so he has ball handling ability that a lot of bigs don't have. He has passing ability and scoring ability that a lot of bigs don't have, especially attacking the basket. And even if he's not applying those skills directly, his experience as a guard puts him in the position of the guard. And so he can better understand the way that the guard is thinking about the game. And that's kind of a function of, don't want to get like too technical into the weeds of the science, but that's kind of a function of how mirror neurons work. If you look at something and you can put yourself in that position because you've been there before, that's going to help you predict what that other player is going to make in terms of decisions. And that will mean that your choices will better match the decisions your guard wants to make.
That's something I touch on a little bit, not mirror neurons. I'm not into it like you are. I have no background in neuroscience, but just for Minute Basketball, the newsletter, I'm talking about short rolling, and it'll be out when this podcast is out, and how it demands things of bigs that they typically haven't been asked to do. and how, you know, the wheat from the chaff, all that kind of stuff. This is guaranteed to be a false equivalency. And you highlighted this in your piece about how it's anecdotal and very small sample size, but the Ball brothers, maybe not with Big Baller brand, but are they indicative of an undercurrent of, let's say, an American version of the beautiful Barcelona youth network, except in America? Do you think that there's more Ball adjacent players coming up?
I hope so. That's the short answer, I guess. But yeah, I do think it is, in many ways, very similar to kind of the U.S. version of Barcelona, the U.S. basketball version of Barcelona soccer. The team was always designed in a way where they were always going to be running, where they were going to mash as many decision-making opportunities as possible into each game duration, no matter what. And every player was going to be asked to make decisions. Like, I talked about the Ball brothers in the piece, but a player who came from Chino Hills, who just recently got drafted this year, who has some pretty good short roll passing chops and is a pretty solid decision maker on both ends of the floor, is Onyeka Okongwu. So I think it shows that, yeah, it's anecdotal because there's only a couple players that we're looking at from Chino Hills, and we're ascribing pretty high praise to them in comparing them to Barcelona, but there's something there. And I've tweeted before, like, get me in a room with LeVar Ball. I just want to pick his brain. I just want to see how he came up with the idea to run this system. Like, is it just because it's aesthetically pleasing and because you're going to put up stats and you're going to be, you know, playing a variety of basketball that is both fun to watch and conducive to winning? Or was there something there in terms of him saying, okay, I want these games to be played at an NBA pace because I want my kids making decisions. I want all my kids handling the ball, at least some more than others, but I want everybody being able to make those decisions. I think there's something there. I think the comparison to Barcelona is fair, and I want to see more youth coaches instill that kind of mentality up to a point. Like, you don't want to just be running just to run, but I think I'd like to see more youth coaches, as far down as we can get in terms of age, putting every player in positions to make decisions, whether they're a guard or a big, because you don't know what they're going to be at the next level. You don't know what they're going to be if they go past the next level. But giving them that diversity and variety of experiences is really important to giving them a baseline for making decisions that you can't predict what decisions they're going to make in the future, but you know that you can prepare them for a lot of decisions.
So that's really interesting to me, is that there's a large overlap in the NBA between the very best passers and guys who make hit-ahead passes, because I think the hit-ahead pass and the proclivity to make that pass is a very good identifier, to use the term, of your processing speed. You see the floor in like an instant, you identify your man, you identify where the other players, the defenders are in relation to him, and you know how far to throw the ball to lead him. All that stuff is like, you could say it in a much more pleasing way, but it's just really good brain worms, the good kind, I think. And so it's very interesting that perhaps LeVar Ball gamified that to some degree. And you look at, there are players who succeed in the smaller aspects of basketball, and oftentimes it's because processing speed, it's proprioception. It's just, to dominate those smaller areas of the court, you have to, you know, be proficient in those areas. It's very interesting.
You know, as a coach of youth basketball and high school basketball, it's the kids that we get that are exposed to different sports is a whole different thing. But, you know, there's so much value in that from a number of different standpoints. We don't have to get into that. But the kids who come up from youth systems, from like AAU, whatever it is, where the coach is consistently calling plays and they're really not allowed to make decisions, or the decisions they make are, well, if this person's not open, this player will be open. Those are our only reads. A, B, C, that's it. The kids that we get who have a more open style, and that's not necessarily to say the more open style is better for youth basketball, but, you know, some structure, that there's a way to balance that. But the kids that we get who have been making decisions from the get-go, who haven't been limited by, okay, this kid is already 6'2". He has to be a post player for the rest of his high school career onwards, if so. Just the exposure to that, they're so much better, and we're so much better for it because there's that open system. So it's so interesting to hear you talk about that, because like you said, now I want to get in a room with LeVar Ball and figure out, like, yeah, is the decision-making something he wanted, something he planned, or is it because his kids have been, you know, playmaking from an early age? They're used to having the ball in their hands, and now they have a sense of where everybody's supposed to be and the decisions they can make because of that. So, you know, just wanted to add that. No questions yet.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's a really interesting example because it raises a question of like a real chicken and egg scenario. Like, did LeVar want the Ball brothers to play fast because he thought it would develop them to make quicker decisions? Or did he think it was the best way to win because they were already good at it? And that's, I don't know the answer to that question, but either way, I think the results speak for themselves. I like that you touched on other sports and how they kind of improve development in basketball too. I think classically players have been told like play basketball year round, like you're specializing. It's good to specialize. And there's some merit to that too. Like you do have to specialize eventually or else you're just gonna be a jack of all trades, master of none. But not only is there research that suggests that there is an injury mitigation component of playing different sports year round, because like basketball is a high impact sport, especially on your joints, especially lower body. And so if you can mix in a different sport that's not on a hardwood, choppy steps, like quick movements like that, maybe it's soccer, maybe it's swimming, tennis, anything like that. Not only are you going to be mitigating injury, probably from the research that I've read, but you're also applying the soft skills that comprise the decision-making in sports to different problems. And while you won't see those exact problems, like you're not going to see like a situation in basketball where, you know, your striker is making a through run behind the center back and you need to know exactly when to time that through ball pass so that he maintains on sides while still, having time to put the ball in the net before the goalie gets there. But a similar problem can be solved in basketball. Like you said, the hit ahead pass. They're very similar passes, just different colored and shaped ball.
Very quickly, like Steve Nash talk about it all the time. He talks about it all the time. His soccer background is he grew up playing soccer and hockey. And by the time he got to basketball in his early teens, it almost felt like cheating because now you could use your hands to make these passes. And so all the reads were already there from his background, but now you have this and, you know, it starts to take off.
Okay, Evan, I know a lot of people know you for your crop tops, but we know you for this, for your great takes on basketball, the philosophy of it, and the no science behind it. For the listeners at home, for the viewers on YouTube, what is chunking?
Yeah, it's a good question. So when I talk about processing speed, that's how fast that you assess all this information and use it to make decisions. And chunking is kind of a subskill of processing speed to me in the sense that it makes that processing speed go faster. So the example I use in the piece is like your classic pick and roll. And so if you haven't seen the pick and roll before, if you haven't seen the way the defense is covering that pick and roll, it's going to take you longer to assess all the variables that are intertwined in that pick and roll and probably longer to enact your solution as well. Now, if you have seen the pick and roll before, you know, you might be able to chunk it and say like, you might be able to group the observations you make together, the things you perceive, especially those variables, together in a way that makes it faster. So instead of saying, okay, I have a pick and roll in front of me, the big has decided not to step up to the level of the screen, you can see it and instead say, okay, I've got a pick and roll in front of me, the big is playing drop coverage. Like that's so much faster, especially when you're talking about multiple variables. So if you add in the way the guard defending the pick and roll is reacting as well, you can say, okay, the defense is playing over and drop. They want to stop the 3-point shot and drive me off the line. That's helpful to me. And so to me, that's what chunking is. It's basically just grouping these variables that you're processing together and maybe even the variables of your solution together in a way that makes them quicker for you to process and enact.
Okay. So this takes us quite economically, I would say, quite efficiently into my DeMar DeRozan thing, a guy who I think he's become very accomplished at chunking in the pick and roll. That is his play. That is his means of playmaking. Now, spent the last few years honing his craft as a playmaker. Tail end of Toronto, he started to become really good. It's what really helped his efficiency. The playmaking started to buoy his shooting numbers. He was more open to shoot. Everything, it's a very good thing for his game. His work ethic is well known as well. Spent a whole summer eating with his left hand, to try and improve that vaunted dribbling that we talked about. I wouldn't be surprised if he spends hours playing Mario Party either, you know, something to that effect. But anyway, so the statistics show him as a top-tier playmaker. I think everybody sees that. But his interpretations seem to be quite rote, mechanical, regimented. He dictates that the defense react to him. He's kind of an overwhelming force going downhill. Good for him. But there isn't really that playmaking flair that you see with, like, the Ball brothers, Jokic, Morant, D'Angelo Russell, those really high feel players who make these, you know, they could get blitzed on a pick and roll on the side, and it wouldn't be something they see very often, but their reaction would be really, really sharp. DeMar DeRozan, when he gets blitzed for a long time, that just completely ended the possession. He just had to reset because his interpretations of the blitzing defense were much worse than his interpretations of, as you say, chunking the variables together, the drop defense. What do you think is the difference as far as the what's going on in, you know, how they're processing that stuff in DeMar versus these generational passers, a guy who worked really hard for it versus these people who we didn't really see the work, and they definitely have put in work, but it just seems effortless to them?
That's a really good question, and I think the answer to it is going to be kind of nuanced, because I think DeMar actually doesn't get enough credit for how far he can be capable of seeing ahead. Like, I think he is pretty capable of making those. The way I like to split it up is, are you making reactive reads or are you making proactive reads? And I think that's the difference between somebody like Zach LaVine, I would say, is more of a reactive passer, but he's gotten better at it. Jaylen Brown, more reactive passer, but he's gotten better at it as well. Those are the two examples I love to use when people ask if you can develop feel, because they've, like, visibly improved. So you think of them more as reactive passers, whereas you think of Jokic, LaMelo Ball, Luka Doncic as more proactive passers, as predictive. They don't wait and see how the defense reacts. They make it happen. I think DeMar doesn't get enough credit as a predictive passer. I think he's probably somewhere in between those two. And DeMar is actually kind of a good comparison for where I'd like to see LaVine take his game next, because it shows, like, you may never be a Jokic, but you can do some things that manipulate a defense yourself without having to just take what they give you. The first step is always kind of taking what they give you. The second is imposing your will. So it's tough, though, because DeMar isn't necessarily a flair passer. He's a passer for utility. And a lot of the time, while he does get a lot of primary ball handler responsibilities, I think he's wired more naturally as a scorer than a passer. And so his first inclination, even subconsciously, is probably, I'm going to get a bucket. And then if that doesn't happen, then he's kind of reacting, taking what the defense is giving him and looking for the pass. And so some of it is experience and some of it is wiring, and those two cannot really be divorced from each other either, because the way you're wired informs your experience and vice versa. So not sure if I 100% answered the question in full, but that kind of gives my thoughts on like the difference between those guys who get a little bit more of a reputation as like rote decision makers versus inventive creative decision makers.
I think it was a great answer, because it introduced the reactive versus proactive, which I think LeBron is like a really interesting passer in the way that he sees the defense and the way he reacts. And so, yeah, I guess the point would be that you wouldn't expect DeMar to have like this insane, hellacious pass in a broken play, but you would expect 14 times during the game for him to make the proper read in the pick and roll to identify, you know, where the weak spot in the, because a lot of teams play weak side zone when everybody collapses on the strong side. He is going to win the game of cat and mouse with the guy in the weak side zone. DeMar's really great at that. And so I'm really interested, what is like the top flight version of the proactive passer in the NBA, and what's the top flight version of the reactive passer in the NBA?
That is a really good question. I'm probably going to make some people mad because I'm going to forget somebody who's a really good example. Like, funny story. I don't know if the listeners and viewers listened to my guest appearance on Thinking Basketball with Ben Taylor, but he asked me for examples of guys who I consider to be like high field players, and I forgot to mention LeBron. So that was a great time. He saved me, though. He bailed me out. But I think LeBron is probably the top example, I would say, of a predictive kind of proactive passer. I think you can also add in like Luka Doncic, LaMelo Ball, Nikola Jokic, James Harden as guys who are predictive passers. And part of what makes them so predictive is that they create the advantage themselves. They create their window themselves. I know we've got a film reel later on that we'll touch on. And a couple of the examples that I already looked at are like great examples of this. So we'll get into it then. But to kind of discuss the more reactive passer, I think it's, I mean, it's basically like, oh, that's such a tough question. So my Bulls brain is telling me Zach LaVine is a pretty good reactive passer at this point, but he's not exactly the best of the best in that scenario. Maybe a good example would be Jason Tatum. I think Jason Tatum is a pretty reactive passer. I don't think he's necessarily gotten to that predictive ability yet, but a lot of the times those reactive guys are wired as scorers first and will take what the defense gives them. And Tatum is a great example of that because he knows his physical tools. He has wonderful proprioception, so he understands how to get himself or the ball through a window. But he's not going to create the window as often as he's going to find it and take advantage of it. So yeah, LaVine, Jason Tatum, maybe, you could probably put any like higher level scoring guards in here, like all-star, all-NBA type scoring guards in here, and they wouldn't be out of place.
When I think of the predictive passers, I just think of guys who kill pre-rotation. Like the defense is trying to, they've seen this before. They see you coming downhill. They know, they're like, hey, we practiced this. This is the shell we preserve. And the guy is already there. He's like, yeah, I know exactly how you're going to defend this. This guy's going to drop here. That passing lane is going to open up. The guy's going to form up off of my drive. That's the lane. It didn't exist, but the pass is already out the hand. And there's a guy there, J.R. Smith in the corner in 2017, something like that.
Just building off of this, we like I said, we talked about this before. This is kind of the intersection of a question you wanted to ask and a question I wanted to ask. And so, Evan, do you think there's any value in a player who is allowed to develop more like the flair aspect versus, you know, the one who, if not A, then B? Like a guy like Facundo Campazzo, he's 5'9", 5'10", but if you watched him play at Real Madrid, he was allowed to do just about anything he could imagine in terms of playmaking, in terms of passing, and he was given that runway. Do you think that like there's value to that versus guys who learn in the very, let's go through the steps type of way?
Yeah, it definitely depends on the player. I think every player learns differently, at least a little bit from each other. And so what works for one player's development trajectory may not work for another. You also have to kind of take into account, like if you're going to enable a guy, like a good example of this is I think PD and I have talked about it and called it daddy ball, where you play for your dad and your dad just lets you like vibe out and do whatever the heck you want. I think that has value because you're just going to get a ton of reps. Like you're going to see a bunch of stuff. You're going to pick a bunch of stuff apart. You're going to fail, but you're going to learn from those failures. And your leash is long, so the failures can happen and not deter you from your ultimate goal, your development trajectory. But at that same time, like this is, there's only so much time the ball can be possessed. It's a zero-sum game. And so whatever you're doing to enable the coach's son type player or the Campazzo, like, you know, just being enabled to make those decisions. Real Madrid wanted to win and they found that enabling him to control the flow of the game was the best way to do so. You're taking away development opportunities from other players and an ability for them to handle the ball and make those kind of mistakes that teach them more, that give them patterns to recognize later on and apply that experience to in the future. And so it's a balancing act. It depends on the player, but I do think like the idea of giving guys a chance to make as many decisions as possible is really, really helpful. It's just that you want to make sure you're giving those opportunities to everybody who wants and can grow from those opportunities. So it's tough. Campazzo is an interesting development case study, I guess, because usually I feel like European ball can be a little bit more regimented, especially from a young age. So I was not familiar with Campazzo in his earlier, younger days, but I have to imagine that he showed some proclivity for making these decisions early on to earn the trust to be able to make more of them. Kind of just like the example I gave when I talked about how difficult it can be to develop ball handling ability.
Samson and I have talked about this a bunch. Is a guy like Bam Adebayo, who at the beginning of last season, he was allowed to bring up the ball, make those mistakes, and, you know, yielded a bunch of high turnover games. But ultimately, now you look at what he did in the bubble in the playoffs and what he's doing on the regular now, those reps, they matter. Shout out to Buddy Boeheim, by the way.
I think Jimmy Butler and Bam Adebayo are maybe the best case of adaptability reigns supreme in the playoffs, just because both of those guys basically anywhere on the floor with their, the way they couple together their proprioception to work in the middle of the floor, their body control and their strength to maneuver there as well. And, you know, after identifying where they are, where everybody else is, it's they're fantastic. I love those two. But
I love that Heat development context. I kind of just want to talk a little bit more about it, because I think the way that Jimmy Butler has developed and the way Bam has developed in that context is kind of a result of the fact that they don't have a classical primary initiator who is both a passing threat and a pull-up shooter. Jimmy is a great passer, but his shooting has always left just a little bit to be desired, especially from three-point. I think he's pretty good in the mid-range. I mean, it depends. He's hit or miss, but the reason why, a big reason why I favor these kind of more egalitarian motion offense schemes as opposed to the heliocentrism that we saw, like classic example is James Harden, but even Trae Young in Atlanta, is that you give the players around the primary so many opportunities to also develop that feel, that decision-making ability. They're not just sitting in the corner waiting for somebody to dime them up for an open shot, right? Like, they're moving off ball. And, like, there are decisions that can be made that don't require you to have the ball in your hand. Cutting is super important because, as Henry Ward has said, like, cutting creates spacing. And it couldn't be more true, but the amount of space that you can create off the ball has, I feel like, a soft ceiling on it. And so you need to be able to balance both those on-ball and off-ball opportunities. And so motion offense puts you in both scenarios, and you have to be able to do both interchangeably, depending on who you're playing with or who you're playing against. So the Jazz are a good example. The Suns are a good example. And I'm kind of glad that NBA offenses have moved a little bit further away from the kind of primary heliocentrism model, at least somewhat. Like, even Atlanta kind of tried to get Trae Young off ball more by bringing in talented players who can also handle. And so it's been nice to kind of see that shift towards a little bit more egalitarian schemes. And I think it will pay dividends in the amount of players that we see who can be trusted to handle the ball, to make decisions on ball, especially, but also off ball. And the talent level of the NBA on average will rise because of it, I think.
So the joke I had was that, was daddy ball versus academy ball. PD calls it academy brain, ascribed to Théo Maledon. You just have to, Killian Hayes' career versus Théo Maledon. At the end of it, you decide which is better, daddy ball or academy ball. And I guess that's the thing. But okay, so this is, I just want to let you wax poetic about Nikola Jokic and kind of your interpretation of his neuro processing, because you brought up heliocentrism, something I love talking about heliocentrism because it's so interesting. And, you know, this is something that I think actually got cut from my Minute Basketball piece, was talking about how you don't enable the players around you, that there's this platonic ideal of a basketball player. And both Bam and Jimmy do kind of, they are the platonic ideal of a basketball player. They can shoot, they can dribble, they can pass, they have the footwork to maneuver around, they're athletic. And the interesting thing is that you kind of don't enable guys to be basketball players anymore when they're a cog in a heliocentric scheme. They're just like props that you move around that have intended functions, and there's not a lot of interplay. Nikola Jokic kind of gives you the benefits of heliocentrism without attaching the negatives. And I think that's maybe a little bit underappreciated, because I think that's one of the biggest aspects that makes him really good, outside of him being just an incredible player. But what do you think about Nikola Jokic, and talk about his brain if you like?
Yeah, Jokic is just like a god. And the reason why he's like my favorite player is because he has every skill that you need to be a dominant on-ball superstar, right? Like, he can shoot, dribble, pass, especially pass, and he's got size that makes him problematic for just about anybody to guard, especially as the league trends away from more traditional centers, right? But he doesn't want to dominate the game, not in the traditional sense, at least. there are like stories that the Denver front office has talked about, and reporters who cover the Denver Nuggets have talked about, where they basically had to sit Jokic down and be like, all right, we need you to dominate the game or we're not going to hit our ceiling. You are our best player. And I think it was after the Nurkic trade. And so Jokic has taken on the mantle slowly but surely, and he's become a little bit more willing to impose his style of play and his just effusive level of skill onto game-like situations or game situations. What I love so much about Jokic, though, is that wiring hasn't completely changed. What I think is so important to success in playoff basketball, and one of the reasons why I'm actually pretty high on the Nuggets despite the loss of Jamal Murray this year, is that playoff teams succeed most often, I think, when they can either employ that kind of motion, everybody, you know, democratic, everybody's involved, egalitarian offensive scheme, or you can rely on heliocentrism. You can pick the path of least resistance, whatever the defense is less equipped and less willing to stop, and you can go that route. So I think the Jazz might struggle because I don't think they have somebody who can take the mantle of a heliocentric creator. I think the Suns are going to do a little better because they employ that motion scheme, but they have either Chris Paul or Devin Booker who can take over games. Some might kind of scoff at the idea that I'm willing to say the Suns have a better heliocentric option than the Jazz. I think Devin Booker is a significantly better passer than Donovan Mitchell. And so for me, that's the difference. But Jokic is the best of both worlds because you can rely on him to be the dominant go-to guy, or you can rely on him to take what the defense is giving him, receive those doubles, and find the open man. And just like you said, like when teams zone up on the weak side, Jokic has seen that a million times and he'll pick it apart in a second. And it's not just that he knows the answer and that he can enact that answer quickly, but he's also willing to do it. Like he wants, the second he gets the ball, he wants to give it back. Like he wants to play hot potato, but he wants to give it back to the person who needs it most at that moment. And so his big, beautiful brain is just the best thing about basketball for me. And I can't wait to see how the Nuggets handle matchups in the playoffs. I don't know exactly. Is it locked in who they're going to be playing in the first round yet? I'm not 100% sure. But I can't wait to see who they play because I want to make a prediction. I want to set a hypothesis. Are we going to see dominant superstar Nikola Jokic, or are we going to see like teammate enabler Nikola Jokic? And that's going to be super interesting for me.
I think what you're talking about, that interplay of heliocentrism plus, you know, that egalitarian democratic offense. And yes, I get it, Sam. You're talking about the Raptors. You might think, Evan, that I do this every podcast, but I don't. I rarely talk about the Raptors. But the Raptors with Kyle Lowry, they had this very segmented offense that was Lowry ball, which as far as the types of shots that he likes to locate and identify for his teammates is actually very similar to Morey ball. It's ironic that right before Morey ball became like a huge thing, they traded away Kyle Lowry. Yes, it's funny. But Lowry was able to commandeer the Raptors' offense into those very efficient landslide runs when it was going properly. Then they were able to get really good offense when Kawhi wasn't a huge part of it. And then when things slowed down for that egalitarian style, it just got chunked up. It wasn't working. You know, not the sequences of your set plays don't always match up. Teams can sniff it out. Then they could go to the heliocentric style for a span of 6 minutes to Kawhi. And that interplay of those two things was largely the reason that the Raptors were able to build a good enough offense to get through the, to win a championship. So I think that is, you hit on exactly it, is the interplay of those two things. Can you polarize outcomes in either sense? And that's one of the biggest things. So I'm glad you brought that up. And your whole thing on Nikola Jokic, I mean, MVP, like you said off the top of the podcast, he's fantastic. Evan, any questions before we go into the film review of the podcast?
Yes, actually, I asked, well, a friend of all of ours, Petey Webb, if he had any questions. He asked me two. I'll ask you, I feel, the more difficult one first. Petey asks, if you were to design an offense to develop a ball handler's feel, what would be the pieces you would want to make their development easier?
Oh, that's a good question. Leave it to our boy to give me a real banger of a question right off the bat. No. So I think in this hypothetical, the idea is that you want to develop the ball handler, right? And that's kind of your primary focus. to be honest, if I just wanted to emphasize the development of one player in the category of on-ball feel, particularly, and you can still develop kind of that off-ball feel with the surrounding parts, the classic surrounding team of a LeBron team seems like a pretty good example. Spot-up shooters and cutters. I just want to get guys around who know how to move and where to move, and I'll dime them up. It's kind of an overly simple answer, I guess, but that takes into account that I'm only developing one player, and the rest of them, you know, they can do whatever they want. I don't care what happens to them. No. But if I did kind of want to develop a scheme in which to develop everybody's feel, but predominantly that primary ball handler, I think I'd go with something almost like what the Suns are doing. Because I do think like that motion offense is helpful, but they do give moments where, they just like let CP or Devin Booker run Spain pick and roll and vibe out. And those moments are important for their development too. You can split up the usage in a way where you are giving more on-ball opportunities to one player who you want to develop as your primary without taking too many on-ball responsibilities off the table for everybody else. Like there are stops in between the Jazz and the James Harden Rockets. And I think if I wanted to develop everybody, I'd find something in between those.
All right. And Petey was insistent I ask you this. He tweeted this out. But same games as they have now, who is a better player? A Jokic-shaped KD or a KD-shaped Jokic?
So I voted on this one. I think it would be, for me, a Jokic-shaped KD. Because if you put that ability to score at all three levels, especially as a pull-up threat, I mean, Nikola Jokic is a good shooter, but Kevin Durant is an otherworldly all-time shooter. If you put that ability to pull up from all three levels into the body of a Nikola Jokic, that's actually really tough. I think I'm still going to go with this answer. You're putting like an on-ball scorer's skill set into like a dominant post big body. And I just like the physical mismatch of that is you can't guard that with anybody basically. Like you would basically have to funnel everything to Rudy Gobert and still you're going to get scored on more often than not. But it's super compelling from the other direction too, because KD shaped Jokic is pretty much Jokic now that he's slimmed down a little bit. And that high level passing ability, like it's a demon to stop, man. Like, it's so hard to predict what Jokic is going to do next. So I wouldn't scoff at either answer, but I think I'd go with the Jokic-shaped KD.
I'm inclined to agree with that, mostly because we've seen how players can age with that skill set. And it's, you know, KD, I don't even think has started to, like, gracefully age given what he's equipped with, and he should. Like, maybe he hangs it up early. Maybe he's like, yeah, like, I'm kind of done with basketball. You know, maybe he wants to do all of his, you know, investing stuff that he's into. Maybe he wants to be, like, on Twitter more often, you know, in some doing all that kind of stuff. Who knows? But KD should be able to just, the same way that LeBron has just been unbelievable in his way to apply himself, so that it's hard to imagine even at, like, 44, that LeBron wouldn't be like at least a league average player because he's so intelligent, and KD and Jokic both are too. And so I think either way, it doesn't matter, you know, who's morphing into whatever body type. I think they're both going to be incredibly valuable players. But okay, I've collected video on what I thought were high feel plays. And since I'm, you know, I haven't done as much work on feel as Evan, obviously, most of the way that I see feel, I think, is because it requires that extra level of reading. To get to your own shot, basically, you only have to get to open space. To create a really good pass for a player, you have to interpret the space they're coming into. You have to interpret their defender guarding that space over there. And you have to get, a lot of the time, into open space for yourself. So it just seems like more moving objects. So it seems like it's more applicable to view feel through playmaking. Of course, there's different ways to do it, like putting guys in jail in the pick and roll after snaking it and stuff like that. That's a good example of it as well. And a video we have here. You, watcher, viewer, you'll have it on screen. But if everybody participating in this podcast could break out the film, and we'll go through it together. Okay, so we have a high pick and roll for Ja Morant with Kyle Anderson. They bail out. He resets in the middle. Ja Morant, little pump fake, comes back up, sets it back up. Okay, so when you're looking at this play, Evan, what are you seeing as far as interpretation? Is he chunking? It, like, of course, you can't say for sure, but if your best guess.
Yeah, so there's definitely some chunking going on, right? So the initial, when he puts the ball on the deck initially, he's exploring kind of the studio space. He wants to see how the defense is going to react to him, you know, looking to create something for himself. And so he gets the reaction he wants, right? The two men step up to him and they leave Kyle Anderson down low, wide open. Now, the angle isn't there, right? They covered the space really well. Both the players who step up to the ball are very tight and there's not space between them, so you can't split them. The classic problem solving advice that I got when playing soccer was look to split pairs. And if you can split pairs, you're going to create advantages. So Ja can't do that right away, but what he does is he manipulates the defense because they sell out to him and they think he's going to create for himself because he was exploring in that way before. So he knows that. He knows that they're going to kind of be on edge and willing to jump for his shot. And so he gets them to bite on a pump fake, and the space that pump fake creates gives him just a split second window to play the ball into Kyle Anderson for a really easy layup. And so he assessed the situation. He saw and chunked that they were both going to double. They were going to hedge the ball handler. He uses his manipulation, a solution that has probably worked for him in the past in terms of that pump fake. And then he exploits the gap that the defense gives him, and it's an easy 2 points.
Okay, now this next one I think should be pretty exciting. Again, Ja Morant. In a play that I think most people, if you're looking at it, you'd initially say is reactionary passing. But upon further review, would probably be predictive, and he just sold it in an unbelievable way. So when you see this play, Ja comes downhill, goes behind his back, tries to get center, and here's the thing. Gets into the paint, and he collects, gathers, looks like he's going to throw a pass cross court to the weak side. Except the guy, Brandon Clark, makes a cut. He's got his hand up for a while, which makes me think, like, is this something that Ja was just selling extra? And he goes up like he's catching like a touchdown pass, except he's releasing it the other way for an oop. So, and then Brandon Clark dunks it, obviously. So I'm curious what you think of that one.
This one is really fun because I think you could either describe it as proactive or reactive, depending on how you see it and what you think the decision he has in mind when he jumps is. I think if you consider that the decision he has in mind is spraying out to the 3-point line for an open Melton jump shot, then this would be considered reactive because he doesn't like the angle of the pass and he decides to throw the lob instead. But I like to think of it as proactive because I think that he knows that Melton is open, and I generally don't like when players jump and then make a decision. But I think, like you said, I think Ja had a decision in mind at the start, and the jump is actually like him weaponizing his immense athleticism to make his decision making easier. So because Ja has such great core strength and such great vertical athleticism, he can jump in the air there and he can hang long enough that he can decide where he wants to go after that. Him hanging, I think he looks off the defender in Melton's direction, and that gives him just that little extra bit of space for the Clark lob. So I think I'd consider this predictive, but he can't lose here is the best part. Like, generally, you don't like a jump pass, and I don't think the defense covered this super duper well because they've got three guys in the paint, but like, it's the Memphis Grizzlies and without Jaren, I believe. So you have to sell out to stop Ja to some extent. And he knows that. He hangs long enough to find the option he likes best. And it's a beautiful highlight play. So really, really nice from him, especially like as a second year player. It's been awesome.
Okay. So, and probably my last plug for the podcast, this is something I talked about in Minute Basketball, was that the more you watch the Grizzlies, the more you realize that, you said, Ja weaponizes his jump passes. Baked into their offensive ethos is that everybody cuts when Ja leaves his feet, that's an underappreciated market in the NBA, and they get to just completely dominate it with Ja. And Jimmy does this as well in Miami, but Ja leaving his feet and guys like Dylan Brooks, Brandon Clark, all punching into space because Ja leaves his feet. And this is where, what would it be? Every defender is going back on things they've experienced their whole life. When the guy leaves his feet, you freeze. and you're trying to identify like a box out or whatever else. But most guys, they just freeze. And so cutting against a freezing defense in what is usually typically very difficult to do, passing from an airborne position, they've schemed in this very unique wrinkle into their offense. And God, do I appreciate it. I think it's one of the coolest things in the league is that the Grizzlies play into this.
Yeah. And can I just add one thing? This, I believe, yeah, based on the fans, it's from his first year. And when I'm coaching or I'm doing like film study, like, you know, you pause it, look snapshot moments. If you look at this moment right here where he is hanging up in the air before he releases the ball to Brandon Clark, like he's reading the defense, and Valanciunas is on a hard sprint right to the basket. The thing I find super cool about this in particular is because I believe, Samson, it was when you talked about the Grizzlies, is he was in this exact same situation where he was staring a hole at the guy at the three-point line, but the low man help defender didn't rotate over in this case. And Valanciunas, to your point, just kept racing to the basket, and he's able to make this insane hanging wraparound. And we'll have the clip here for the viewer, but it's just his growth is...
Yeah, because he could just rely on his athleticism, right? Like, he's a freak athlete. The dude is so athletic. And I think growing up, he probably did weaponize the athleticism a lot, but he's such a high field player for a guy who is so athletic, and it's not often you see that combination of skills. So you can tell, and I know that he's an example of a guy who has done some really weird things in terms of training. Ja, like, was not a highly rated college recruit, and he ended up the second pick in the NBA draft. So, like, there is a lot going on in terms of Ja Morant's development. That's another development system, like, coaching experience that, like, I'd love to pick his brain and his trainers to see what they were doing in the offseason to make these big leaps, because they've done something great here.
So this next play is iconic. It made the rounds on every highlight show you're watching. Most people watch the show. There's a decent number and a growing number of people who listen, so thank you for listening. You probably should watch, though. You'll get more out of it, but thank you for listening anyway. You'll recognize this play right away. It's Luka snaking the pick and roll, getting to the opposite side of the floor, and then going up for a jumper, wherein he releases the ball backwards to a shooter behind him. So this is just like a moosh boosh. There's so much going on here. I'd like to hear what you think of it.
So this one is a lot of fun. Luka utilizes so many things that I consider to be like savvy, high feel, manipulative moves here. So like Dwight rolls, I think it's Roko is on Luka's back. And so Luka keeps him in jail. Luka hits a little behind the back cross to kind of freeze CJ and is this Cantor? I think it's Cantor. This is from this year. Yeah, Cantor's back. I forgot about that. Anyway, so he uses the little behind the back cross to freeze CJ and Cantor. Roko's in jail, can't get to the ball without fouling. And there's a split second where you see Luka look to his left, to the guy out on the three-point line. I think it's Tim Hardaway Jr. And at that moment, he knows where he's going to go. But the defense doesn't. And I will say Luka is helped a little bit by the fact that CJ is out to lunch. Like, I don't know who he thinks he's guarding, but he's not guarding anybody here. But like, still, Luka's process is perfect here in the sense that he gets CJ to commit just to rule out the chance that CJ is going to find his responsibility and get to it. And once the commit is there, like, he just throws the fancy little pass as a cherry on top. And it's just, the process is so fun to watch because you can see him, like, if you stop start this a couple times during the clip, you can see his whole process start to finish and identify exactly where he makes the decisions. And it's awesome.
Okay, so another Luka, and interestingly, like the inverse of the Ja Morant play earlier. So Luka rejects the screen, and then, well, is it a rejection? Is DeAndre Jordan flipping the screen? Or is it both? Whatever. He comes back around, runs a pick and roll. Joe Harris tries to get around, and Luka snakes again, jump stop, goes up. Like, he's going to pass to the weak side corner, only Maxi Kleba makes like a really sharp basket cut, and it's that same airborne lob pass from the, you know, the throw-in type of you look like you're gonna throw the ball in from the sideline in a game of soccer. It's yeah. So thoughts on that?
This one is really fun too, because you can tell there has to be some communication from the cutter on the weak side. Well, I guess it's the strong side here, but the cutter on the strong side and Luka, because Luka looks in his direction and he doesn't like, I think the angle is fine. I think Luka could make that pass, no problem, but he doesn't like how close the low man is to the shooter. And so it's not really a high efficiency shot opportunity in his mind. And so he looks at the guy on in the left side corner, and that is the signal to cut. Like, I have to imagine that they discuss this in practice. Like, if I look at you in the scenario, I want you to cut. And so the cut is made, and Luka weaponizes that kind of deception, the threat of his own shot. He goes up and looks like he's going to either throw something out to the arc or take a shot himself. And that just leaves the cutter wide open. And all it takes is that split second look off from Luka, that split second where the defense thinks, is he going to shoot it? Is he actually going to throw it to the cutter? Is he going to find somebody out on the arc? And that split second is all he needs to make the defense look silly.
Super fun. Next one is D'Angelo Russell, straight pick and roll. And it's against the Wolves. So he's trying to get Karl-Anthony Towns. Number 12. Who was number 12 last year? I can't remember. Anyway, so D'Angelo Russell is getting downhill, puts his defender in jail, and makes him choose which side of him he's going to catch up on. He chooses the side to catch up where he gets to defend the pocket pass, so that's not a straight two-on-one. Then D'Angelo Russell, playing that game of cat and mouse, is able to get into his sidestep to his right little jump shot that he loves from the mid-range. So in this scenario, it looked like D'Angelo is trying to get in a position where, sure, we'll get the two-on-one, or I can just use an escape dribble to get into my jumper. Whatever you choose, I'll beat you. And that's what it looks like to me. Interested to hear what you think.
This one is really interesting because I almost wonder if this is actually what he / the coach wanted from this play. So he gets the defender in jail, but he kind of lets him out. And he opts for a shot, which I consider to be a pretty tough look. D'Angelo Russell is a pretty good tough shot maker from the mid range. So for him, this is probably a pretty good look. But I honestly, like, for me, if I was coaching, I don't know if I'd like that look so much. This is a pretty close game and an interesting choice by D'Angelo Russell, given the circumstances. But he does know his strengths in the sense that he can get to his sidestep. And so for him, I think it's a pretty good look. But I don't know if that was designed or not, but it worked. So, you know, who can complain?
What did you make of the interplay of the guy chasing him as far as like his proprioception in that sense? That's why I chose that play, basically.
Yeah, he does have really good sense of where he has the defender. And so even though he does kind of let him out of jail, he lets him out at a point where I think he feels pretty comfortable knowing that he can get to a step back in time for it to be a pretty clean look. So honestly, like, the more I look at it, the more I think this is something that gets D'Angelo Russell playing to his strengths. And if you're playing to your strengths, that's a high feel opportunity, in my opinion.
Yeah, just wanted to add, it's I'm a nerd, so I know this. Travion Graham, I think I'm like 90% sure it's true.
Yep, you're right.
But the thing I really enjoy about this is it's the micro skill of, if you watch, as he gets past, when Graham is going to cut him off at his spot, their arms get caught up and D'Lo does that little swipe through swim move that gets him right in balance for that jumper. Just something I wanted to highlight.
Oh, that's a really good observation. I didn't even notice the left arm interplay there. That's a really nice move. That the more evidence, like, the more I watch it, the more I think that D'Angelo, like, is very comfortable getting to this spot, and he manipulates the defense pretty well there, I think.
Yeah, he does this all the time. And the thing that, like, if D'Angelo Russell was more interested in getting fouls, this type of interplay would be way more valuable to him. You see guys like Jimmy Butler who just spam and jerk back and forth and are frenetic in the middle of the floor. Like, I can't remember if Jimmy Butler set the free throw rate record last year or if he just got damn close, but his ability to just be very frenetic in the middle of the floor, it's just got guys climbing on his back, jumping into him, all that kind of stuff. If D'Angelo cared more about getting to the free throw line, he'd be able to use this type of feel in a very effective sense, kind of like Trae Young. We talked about this on the podcast way earlier. Everybody talked about this on their podcast, you know, Trae Young jumping back into people. Like, is it cheesy? Yes. Do I blame Trae? No. The NBA should write their rules better so that there's not that room for interpretation. But to credit Trey, it's not easy to put, it's not easy to compromise NBA players over and over and over again like that. And he was doing it. I don't like watching it, but anyway.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, I think that's an under discussed aspect of feel actually is like under, like one of the variables of the way that you're playing a game, the game is your understanding of the rules and the referee. Like those are variables too. And if you understand the rules, like James Harden is the perfect example of this. If you understand the rules, you can put the referees in tough positions where they have to make a call one way or the other, and they're going to get it wrong sometimes. And more often than not, if you know what you're doing, the amount of time they get it wrong is going to benefit you more than it benefits the other team. And sometimes all it takes is those couple extra points you get from cheesy foul calls to win a game. So yeah, it's not always the most fun thing to watch, but like it is pretty masterful for sure.
James Harden is akin to a lawyer who found precedent from a case in 1938, and the loophole is too difficult to fix for the state, so they're not going to do it. So he gets to keep using it for all the clients himself who is being erroneous in that type of way. So yeah, there's.
Have you guys ever seen Better Call Saul? Can we just call James Harden Slippin' Jimmy? I feel like that's a perfect comparison.
Slippin' Jimmy, baby. That's James Harden Slippin' Jimmy. Okay, next play, dribble handoff now. D'Angelo is on the Wolves. So D'Angelo gets a dribble handoff from Karl-Anthony Towns. That interplay should be very interesting for their careers, however long they spent together. He comes baseline, and it looks like the guy is above the break, about to catch the pass, but it's the passing window that's available to D'Angelo Russell is more open to a pass that's closer to the corner. He finds that. His teammate finds that. And not just with D'Angelo in this play, but I'm wondering what you think of the cutter's feel in this example.
I mean, I don't know if he got some kind of signal from D'Lo here or what, but like the cut is perfect. Like, because there's no way D'Lo is going to be able to make that pass if he doesn't make the cut. The angle is terrible where he was before. And the angle is like not particularly great once he does make the cut, but it makes the pass possible. And so like I talked about earlier, the advice I always got when I was playing soccer is to split the double. D'Lo does it here in a way where he's either going to make the pass or he's going to get fouled more likely than not, I would say. He puts himself in a pretty perilous position being that close to baseline. He's like almost trapped, and his only recourse is really to make the pass, but he knows he can make it, and he times it perfectly. Like he leads that pass for the cutter right to the shooting pocket, and it's just a great look. So this one is just like, I mean, this is a world-class pass. Like I don't even know what processing had to go on before it aside from recognizing that the cutter was making that cut, but like what a ridiculous pass.
Yeah, the interesting thing, like we talked about earlier, it's your teammates.
Wait, also, low feel from Vanderbilt, who absolutely should have set the screen on Cole Anthony, by the way. Just as like a, I think a lot of clever players would have set the screen on Cole Anthony, but instead Vanderbilt tried to show from the dunker spot in the paint that had like seven people in there at that moment in time. So,
and I don't blame him too much just because like, I think that he thinks that D'Lo is going to have to put something up and try to draw a foul. So he's like, oh, I'm going to get the rebound, but he just doesn't understand or doesn't predict that D'Lo can make that pass. And like fair play to him. That's a ridiculous pass for him to pull off. Not a great play. Like I definitely do think he should have set that screen on Cole, but it's such a tough decision in real time.
Yeah, that's, but I mean, I also want to give, like you guys talked about, give credit to the cutter. Like Ricky Rubio, I don't know if I'm sure he's been put in that position before and he's had to make a pass similar to that. But just his, you know, he's been put in that position. So he knows, hey, if I can get to this spot, like I'm going to get open. And maybe D'Lo is one of the only other guys who can throw that pass, especially on the Wolves. So.
The funny thing is this kind of touches back to the AD example I gave where Ricky Rubio has been in both the position D'Lo is in this play and the position where Ricky finds himself in this play. And so he understands this angle from D'Lo's perspective in a way that allows him to recognize the cut where most other players would not. So this is an awesome clip because not only is D'Lo making a really high field play, but so is Ricky Rubio. And Rubio demonstrates both kind of like the mirror neuron principle I was talking about before and the importance of feel, even if you don't have ball in hand.
Yeah, excellent. Okay, so the next, I just have three plays of the interplay of how Manu Ginobili ran pick and roll. I know Manu is considered like a very high feel player in, you know, the annals of basketball history. So there's just a few different, some come off of dribble handoff, some are just straight pick and roll. and the passes he makes and how he leads Duncan into space while still occupying both defenders, I think is pretty great. And there should be three plays, I think, here for us.
Yeah, these are all really great. And they're at least two of them are pretty similar because Duncan slips the screen, and it's something that him and Manu did together so well. Like, not only like it's easy to say that like you can slip the screen there and it makes an easy opportunity to split the pick and roll defenders, but to know exactly when to split that screen and to make that cut takes a lot of practice, like, and coordination with the ball handler, really. Like, I can't imagine how many times Duncan and Manu had to run this and like mess it up until they got the timing down to the point where Duncan could consistently slip and Manu could consistently split that those pick and roll defenders. But it just shows like feel, like high feel is super useful pretty much in every case, but it's worth more than the sum of its parts if the players around you are also high feel, because it means that every variable on in your context is going to put themselves in the best position to succeed. And I think that's one of the reasons why the Spurs were so successful, especially running that kind of motion egalitarian scheme, is because everybody knew where to be, both from being super well coached by all-time great Greg Popovich and also just like having lots and lots of experience and chemistry with each other to know exactly where everybody was going to be and what opportune positions were for each player and their skill set.
Okay, so, and like, here's the thing too, is that anybody knows that passing a pocket pass, those passes to the slip, a big man moving downhill and trying to corral the pass is ripe for the picking from like dig downs and stuff like that. So the attention to detail of Manu to use his pivots and his body control, his hips, to maintain passing angles to where only Duncan could collect the ball and that a guy can't come from his backside and pick it before it happens. Like, how many fast breaks have been started in the little bounce pass to the guy slipping that just gets picked and headed out the other way? All the time. So huge credit to Manu. It's the like minutia of running the pick and roll that I don't think a lot of people pay attention to that really makes it go, is the angles that you're maintaining and creating. And that's, you know, to go back to the last clip, D'Angelo and Rubio in concert with each other, maintaining an angle and elongating it throughout the possession. Pretty great.
And Manu's deceleration, like deceleration has gotten a lot more credit as a tool in the grand scheme of athleticism nowadays, but I think it's still probably a little underappreciated. Like, Manu uses his immense ability to decelerate here in a way that keeps the defense on their toes. Like, they don't know what to expect next because they didn't expect him to stop short at the top of the key, like, or at the top of the free throw line. Like, that's not a good shot for him, but they don't know what he's going to do next, even though they probably should have been watching film of Timmy slipping that pick and roll more consistently. But yeah, so it just goes to show, like, your tools are only as good as your brain can make them work.
Okay, and one last clip. James Harden getting George Hill on a cross, heading downhill. Defender steps up. He goes airborne behind the back pass to Dwight Howard. Yes, we're in the time machine. We're going quite a ways back. But yeah, last clip. What do you think?
So this one's really good. Harden can't lose here because I think either he's going to get fouled or he's going to get an easy bucket for either Dwight or Trevor Ariza. Ariza's sitting out at the kind of at the top of the slot with a pretty open look, but the angle's not great. And so James Harden knows he's pretty strong and he's liable to get foul calls, probably less than because he's not getting those big time star foul calls, but he's still going to get them, especially with the downhill ability that he has. And so he attacks the rim knowing that something good is going to happen. It's really interesting to see Dwight Howard maintain that space. And it's something that I think Morey Ball pivoted away from once Dwight left the team. But he holds that space down low in kind of an opportune position to convert the dunk. And so James has two easy options here for him, at least for a player of his passing ability. Or he can just go up, force the contact, and try to get a foul call. I think once he bumps the defending player, he knows he's not going to get the call, especially because the defender is, I think, in the restricted area, as far as I could tell. But the perception to know that he's not going to get the call and to be able to process the positioning of the defender, like, James probably isn't looking down, but he still knows where the defender is in the court. So that spatial recognition is really important, both in how much space he has to close, how fast he can close it, and who's going to be there to meet him. And then to put the cherry on top yet again, he picks the perfect pass for the guy with the highest efficiency opportunity.
Okay, Evan, before, I think we've taken enough of Evan's time, so I think, I don't know how long this is, it's probably an hour longer than we initially intended, as we are wont to do, but before we get out of here, do you have any final questions for Evan?
None that will, you know, be resolved quickly or easily. I reached out to a bunch of people, a bunch of coaches, and I can DM Evan. We can talk about this after, but we'll keep it under 2 hours. That's the goal for right now.
Sorry, guys. I have a tendency to go a little longer than I plan on.
Evan will be back on.
Oh no, we would have this be like 5 hours long. If that would be, that's probably not something that's palatable for the viewer, but. Multiple episodes. You are welcome on anytime.
Thank you, guys. I appreciate that.
Okay, so before we get out of here, what we've done with, you know, previous guests, I've seen too many episodes of Hot Ones. I do this on my podcast with Raptors Public, but the floor is yours, Evan, to plug away. And then at the end of it all, Evan and I will excitedly say, cosign. Go read it and listen to it all.
Yeah, so you can find me on Twitter at @easy_hoops. I do a lot of tweeting. Not all of it is about basketball. Some of it is just for funsies. So that's always a good time. My DMs are always open if you have any questions or anything. Love to talk ball with anybody and everybody. Doesn't even have to be basketball. It can be soccer ball, whatever. Can find my written work at premiumhoops.org. We've got a lot of really fun stuff in the pipeline for Premium Hoops, especially as the draft is nearing. I know we're going to do some fun stuff with that. We're hoping to do a little bit more WNBA coverage with the WNBA season starting pretty soon here. By the way, quick shout out, WNBA League Pass is like $17. Go out and get it. The product is so awesome to watch, and it's going to be an awesome, awesome season. Besides my work on Premium Hoops, you can find the Feel piece and a little bit other, a couple other of my select, writings on my blog, easyhoops.co. And then hopefully, I'm going to have that dexterity piece, dexterity and dribbling piece coming. God, I hope I can get it out in the next month or two, but it's going to be a work. So we'll get it out when we get it out, but it should be fun once it's out there. I may have something surprise and fun coming soon. Quite possibly something that I haven't done before. So that's going to be a little bit of a secret, but like to tantalize the listener / viewer with a little bit of a surprise there. So keep your eyes peeled. Follow me on Twitter to find out what's coming next.
Okay. Evan, can't co-sign it enough. I enjoy your work immensely. And I think, you know, as I've said throughout this podcast, it's novel work. It's unique in the space. Not only is it unique, but it's incredibly well done, because those two things don't always go hand in hand. Some people do really popular work really well. Some people do really interesting work and you're like, oh, there could be more here. Typically my stuff falls in that, but yours is, it's the perfect mix of both. Actually, I'll say, since you brought up the WNBA thing, I'll plug my own Twitter, because yesterday I gave away 3 League Pass accounts. I did the same thing last year. Every once in a while, I do like a raffle, and you don't have to follow like for any of this stuff. You just have to respond, but I'll do a raffle to give out money to like Black creators who are trying to get into sports media and stuff like that. So if you're looking to just be in tune with some of that stuff that I do, just follow my account and you might have an opportunity to get some free money. Not that I'm like Daddy Warbucks or anything, but it could be a nice side effect. And I guess you will be in proximity to my It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia tweets. Which, you know, maybe that's good too. But Evan Gualberto, do you have anything to say before we get out of here?
Yeah, I just want to, since we're talking WNBA, I would be remiss if I didn't. I am working on something right now that covers the WNBA in a manner similar to bouncing around. But I could talk about that on my own time. We'll have all of Evan's stuff in the description below. You can click on it. It's not anywhere near the annotations and bibliographies that Evan has or SNS has, but it's pretty comprehensive for a YouTube description. So Evan, thank you for coming on.
You guys, I totally forgot to plug my pod. Yeah, I'd be remiss not to mention Sense and Scalability. It's been so much fun. Like, I'm finally doing the podcast that I really have always wanted to do. We mentioned at the top, look into a lot of philosophical aspects of ball, anything ranging from player development to scouting to roster construction. So come check us out. It's been a great time so far, and we'd love to have you on board. But thank you guys so much for having me again. It's been awesome. I'd be happy to join back at any time. You guys are great, and I love the work you guys are doing. Can't wait to see what's coming next.
Was muted for a second there, but yes, Evan, thank you. Your picture will hang. It's just over there off screen in the Bouncing Around Hall of Fame. Yourself, PD Webb, who we currently have pictured, Brent Berry and Caitlin Cooper. And so yeah, it's been an honor. You've so many of the answers you gave today I found so illuminating and so enriching. So I hope the listener enjoys it, but even if nobody listens to this podcast, this was an excellent 2 hours spent for myself. I imagine it's the same for my co-host as well. So a huge appreciative thank you for coming on. Listener, thanks for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed it, but we're out of here. So see ya. Niggas wanna hate on us. Niggas be envious. I know why they hating on us. Cause the style so fabulous. I'ma be real on us. Nobody got nothing on us. Girls be all on us from London back down to the US. We rockin' this contagious. The intros for the podcast. Just confess your girl admits that. Bang, dude.
I trust you guys to make the selection then. I'm interested to see what you guys pick.
Okay. You'll see.
Love it. Can't wait.